السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. So welcome back, brothers and sisters. Another episode of our journey through the tafsir of Surah Taha. So let's get right into it because, you know, of course, as you all know, we've been off for a couple of days, but alhamdulillah, we are here. I gotta be honest with you, man. I don't think I want to do that again. Unless something really important comes up, to be off for 2 days like that, it just didn't sit right with me. I'm so into this routine. I miss being able to talk to you guys about certain things. I also learn a lot when I'm speaking and I'm studying. So we're going to try to keep this as consistent as we can, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. And like I said, unless something important comes up. So we are now at verse number 83 of Surah Taha. So let's begin, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues and he says, وَمَا أَعْجَلَكَ عَنْ قَوْمِكَ يَا مُوسَى وَمَا أَعْجَلَكَ عَنْ قَوْمِكَ يَا مُوسَى. Allah asks him, why were you in such a rush, ya Musa? Why did you rush to get here? What is it about you that caused you to leave everyone behind? And we alluded to this in the previous episode, but here what I really want to talk to you about is the fact that everything when it comes to prophets and messengers has to be done at a specific time. Prophets and messengers are not allowed to rush through things. They're not allowed to be in a hurry when it comes to revelation and executing that revelation. So that's a really, really profound insight of what prophethood is like. Everything has to happen at a specific time. So if they try to jump ahead, there's consequences for that. So the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he sees that Musa alayhi salam has arrived at Mount Tur, and he asks Musa alayhi salam, why'd you come here so quickly? Why were you in such a rush? Look what Musa alayhi salam says. وَمَا أَعْجَلْكَ قَوْمِكَ يَا مُوسَى قَالَ هُمْ أُولَى. So here's number one. He says, them. Them, meaning Bani Israel, meaning my followers. They're right over there. هُمْ أُولَاءِ عَلَىٰ أَثَرِي. They're right there by my footsteps. So the first thing he says is, oh Allah, I didn't actually leave them that far behind. They're right over there. And they're at my footsteps. So عَلَىٰ أَثَرِي عَلَىٰ أَثَرْ. أَثَرْ, meaning you could see the prints. So at least they're not too far back. وَعَجِلْتُ إِلَيْكَ رَبِّي لِتَرْضَى. And I rush towards you, O Allah, to make you happy. Subhanallah, that was Musa alayhi salam. He's so innocent. We've said this quite a few times. He's so innocent in his thinking that he'll make a decision and not realize, wait a minute, I'm not supposed to do that, but he does it with a pure heart. So he says to Allah Azza wa Jal, they're right over there. They're not far away. And oh Allah, I actually came this quickly because of you. I wanted to come to you. I thought that this would have made you happy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, قَالَ فَإِنَّا قَدْ فَتَنَّا قَوْمَكَ. Indeed, your people, they are going through a difficult trial. مِن بَعْدِكَ وَأَضَلَّهُمُ السَّامِرِي. Right where you left them behind you. And Samiri has misguided them. We all know who Samiri is, the troublemaker amongst Bani Israel. There was this one man, his sole purpose was to kind of degrade Musa alayhi salam as much as he could. So even though the Musa alayhi salam had all of these abilities, these miracles by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's permission, Samiri was there to just show, oh, he's just a human. Oh, he's going to lead us to destruction. Look, he brought us to the river. Now he's going to lead you all to death. And each and every time when Musa alayhi salam was able to get them through those difficulties, Samiri was always the troublemaker behind the scenes. So Allah Azza wa Jal says, Samiri is up to no good. And you left him behind there with those people. So what happened here? Samiri, so there's a story here. I'm going to step out of the tafsir for a second. The people of Bani Israel, okay, when they were living with Fir'aun amongst the Egyptians, they were considered to be the honest people of Egypt. So these are the followers of Musa alayhi salam. They were considered to be the honest people of Egypt. And what those who were committed to Fir'aun, what they used to do is all of their jewelry, their gold, all whatever items they had that were expensive, they would give the honest people to keep them. So that was kind of like their security box or their bank account, because obviously you can trust them. So they used to store all of this wealth and gold amongst Bani Israel. Now, when the call was made for Bani Israel to move and follow Musa alayhi salam, it was happening. Remember, we mentioned it happened in the darkness of the night. They couldn't go back to the Egyptians and return all of their jewelry and wealth, because they would have immediately known, you guys are going somewhere. Where are you guys going? So they ended up taking all of this stuff with them. So what they said is that they went back to Samiri. And this is when Musa alayhi salam was already up with Allah and he's at Mount Tur. And they said to Samiri, like, we have all of this jewelry. What are we supposed to do? That's going to come a little later, what the response was. But Samiri, what he did is when he saw all of this jewelry and this additional wealth that he knew did not belong to Bani Israel, he took advantage of it. That's where I got the title of this video from. And I'm going to talk to you about that a little bit more at the end of this video. But he saw an opportunity and he knew that these people were honest. So he started to make them feel guilty that, look, you guys have all of this jewelry. We brought it this far and it's not even yours. This belongs to the Egyptians. So we need to do something about this jewelry. We need to bring it all together and we need to burn it. And he came up with this concept that if we burn it and we make an idol, that will keep us focused on the message of Musa alayhi salam. And this, unfortunately, this is one of the reasons why idol worship still exists today, is that you want something, people who worship idols want something to kind of concentrate and dedicate their focus towards. So some religions, they don't actually bow down and worship the idol, but they utilize the idol to help them focus in their day-to-day lives. So they can concentrate on Allah or God or whoever it is through this idol. So that's why you'll see idols, you know, will be shaped and designed with such detail. Because sometimes you're looking at the idol and what do you think? It's kind of looking back at you. So that interaction, that's what they wanted. So it's like, oh, the idol's watching me. Let me just behave myself. Let me do what I'm supposed to do. So Samiri came up with the same idea. So they started bringing all of their jewelry together. They melted it out. They created and made this calf. Allah Azza wa Jal will mention this, right? فَأَخْرَجَ لَهُمْ جَسَدًا. We're coming to that verse in a moment. So they made this calf together and they molded it, and Samiri designed it in such a way that when the wind would blow against the calf, it would make a moo sound. So when the people heard that the calf would moo, they thought that the calf was alive. So they started to worship the calf. So that's how the background story of how that happened. I'm going to say there's one more point to the story. I'm going to save that till the end, inshallah. Let's not jump the gun here. So they're going through this fitna right now. Musa alayhi salam is with Allah and Allah informs him of what's happening to his people and what Samiri has done. فَرَجَعَ مُوسَى إِلَىٰ قَوْمِ. So Musa returned back to his people. غَضْبَانَ أَسِفَ. He was extremely angry. أَسِفَ is that he held his anger in. Like the inside of him was boiling with anger. So Musa alayhi salam is extremely upset. قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ. He says, oh my people. أَلَمْ يَعِدُكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ وَعْدًا حَسَنًا. Didn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already promised you a promise that was worthy, righteous? أَفَطَالَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْعَهْدِ. Was I gone for a long time? This is his question to all of them. Did I leave you guys for days and days and days? I just went for a little, just for a while. I wasn't gone for very long. أَمْ أَرَدْتُمْ أَنْ يَحِلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ غَضَبِي. أَمْ أَرَدْتُمْ أَنْ يَحِلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ غَضَبٌ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. Or is it that you prefer the wrath and the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your master? فَأَخْلَفْتُمْ مَوْعِدِي. So you went against my instructions. I told you guys to wait here, don't do anything, relax while I go up to Mount Tur. And, you know, he receives the commandments from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he puts them all on the spot and he starts lecturing them. This is what leadership is about. When you see your people and your followers making mistakes, you have to be able to stand up and address those problems. You can't keep them lingering. And even in the business world, this continues. So presidents and CEOs, the moment they see that something is going to affect their business in some way, or they see sales are starting to depreciate. Somehow they gather the team immediately, sit down, and they start working through the problem. So that's what Musa alayhi salam, he's not just reprimanding them, but he's also like, don't you guys realize the consequence of what you've done? You're literally asking for Allah's anger here. And they respond, قَالُوا مَا أَخْلَفْنَا مَوْعِدِكَ. We didn't actually go against your promise and what you told us to do. بِمَلْكِنَا وَلَكِنَّا حُمِّلْنَا أَوْزَارًا مِّن زِينَةِ الْقَوْمِ. But instead we were carrying all of this wealth, this jewelry from a people, meaning the Egyptians. We had their stuff. By the way, guys, this means that you see, Bani Israel still had iman in them. They still had faith. So despite that they followed the instructions of Samiri when Musa a.s. wasn't around, they still had iman, because they realized that the guilt of having somebody else's property, they were not comfortable with it. So they explained that to Musa. فَقَذَفْنَهَا فَكَذَلِكَ أَلْقَى السَّامِرِي. So they threw it away, and so did Samiri as well. فَأَخْرَجَ لَهُمْ عِجَلًا جَسَدًا لَهُ خُوَارٌ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes that, and they basically tell Musa alayhi salam that, so we took all of our jewelry, we threw it, even Samiri took his own jewelry, he threw it, they melted it, they made this calf, and أَخْرَجَ لَهُمْ عِجَلًا. عِجَلًا is a calf. جَسَدًا لَهُ خُوَارٌ. Keep in mind the word jasad, there are several words for body in Arabic. Jism, badan, you have jasad. Jasad is the body that has no blood in it. It has no internal organs. So Allah says that the calf is a jasad. It's hollow inside. It's useless, right? Khuwar, it made a moo sound. Some of the scholars said it was shaitan. Others say it was the way the idol was designed, that when the wind would hit it, it would make a sound. فَقَالُوا هَذَا إِلَهُكُمْ وَإِلَهُ مُوسَى فَنَسِي. So they explain, and Samiri continues, and he says to all of them, this is your ilah, this is what you should worship. وَإِلَهُ مُوسَى, and this is also the god of Musa, this calf. فَنَسِي, perhaps he maybe forgot. He forgot who his god was. So you see what's happening here. Samiri is almost taking the exact same approach as Fir'aun. Because, I mean, he used to work with Fir'aun. He was with Fir'aun. So he's taking the same approach. And he's basically manipulating all of the followers of Musa and trying to convince him that this was actually the original teachings that Musa alayhi salam was supposed to follow. But he forgot, or he lost track of that. Here is where, it's this ayah and the previous verse where I got the title from. Because the lesson for all of us here, brothers and sisters, is kind of scary actually. In this day and age, there are businesses around the world, Muslims in particular, that take advantage of the weaknesses of other Muslims. And as a result, they'll design things, they'll create things where they say to you, if you use this, it'll help you become closer to Allah. And I'll give you an example. I could remember very clearly, because it only happened once. I was walking in the markets of Medina, and I saw one of those stalls that were selling the tasbih. So I walked inside and I started looking at all of these tasbih, endless amount of colors and designs and so on. And I'm just looking at it. Now, I've never used a tasbih and I hope I never have to, but if I ever need to, you know, I'll deal with it at that time. So I was looking at all of these tasbih and I just came across one that felt really nice, the quality, etc. But I was just browsing. The sales guy tells me, he goes, if you use this, لو تستعملها, you know, if you use this, لَيَزِيدَ لَكَ الْبَرَكَةَ, it's going to increase you in blessings from Allah. And I remember I stopped there and I was so confused. What is this guy really saying to me? He's trying to sell me this thing, but he's doing it in such a way that I will get closer to Allah by using this thing. That's what happens. And unfortunately, the victims behind this kind of propaganda that comes, you know, unfortunately, either from a business perspective or anywhere else, is that you pretty much prey on the weaknesses, the lack of knowledge that Muslims may have. So you convince them that, here, look, if I write your name on this paper, I'll spit on it a few times, I'll recite some Quran, put it on your chest, wrap it around, wear it for 3 days, all your problems will go away. So like amulets, right? And today now it's a multi-million dollar business. You know, you'll have beautiful ornaments, beautiful things that you hang in your car, and somebody will say to you, if you put this in your car, then you'll always be safe. Just make sure that when you step into your car, you touch it three times and you say Allah, 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 or some bizarre thing. And subhanAllah, that's the problem. That's what Samiri did with these people. You know, these amulets, they're not airbags that are going to stop you from an accident. You know, they're not shields that are going to stop you from pain and struggle. They're just pieces of paper, or they're just wood, or they're just ornaments with designs on them. That's it. You know, and even unfortunately, people today commit shirk with the Quran. Let me give you an example. The same book, this is our book of guidance, but at the end of the day, what is the actual Quran? The actual Quran is the text itself. But for you and I to visually see the text, we are looking at what? Ink and paper. So at the end of the day, although that this is the Quran is the actual text of Allah that's memorized and studied. But for the people who don't do that, you could easily give them the Quran and say, look, you know, before you leave your home, make sure you have a Quran in your closet somewhere. Take it, just wave it around your house a little bit. It'll keep off all the spirits. This is not an alarm system, you know, that protects your home. So this is what happened. This is the weaknesses that unfortunately there are businesses, and there's even leaders that I've seen and I've met and heard of many, and I'm sure a lot of you know as well, that prey on these weaknesses. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us strength. You see why it's so important to engross yourself in learning, why you have to keep consistent. You have to keep consistent with that dedication of constantly educating yourself to the best of your ability. Otherwise, you become prey to these kinds of propaganda, these kinds of individuals that take advantage of you. And all of the magicians and the sorcerers are there. They charge you $5,000 and say, give me your t-shirt. Soak it in some Zamzam water or something. Start writing a whole bunch of mumbo-jumbo Arabic writing and numbers and put it all together. And said, look, I put a spell. Now I know he'll marry you. So you don't have nothing to worry. You don't even have to work for his love anymore. He'll marry you. And the same thing, you know, if she's not inclined towards you, do this, do that, muster up some craziness. Don't worry, she's yours. Done. Allahu musta'an. So that whole idea, that whole concept, that attitude, that practice actually started with Fir'aun and those who followed him. Subhanallah. So be careful, guys. Be careful. This is why it's so important to ask questions. This is so important for you to research and make sure that you do that in a way that you're not researching the wrong thing. You're not talking to the wrong people, people that are not qualified. You ask questions and you make sure that you get your answers from people that are qualified to give it to you. So Allah Azza wa Jal continues, أَفَلَا يَرَوْنَا. Don't they see? أَلَّا يَرَجِعُ إِلَيْهِمْ قَوْلًا وَلَا يَمْلِكُ لَهُمْ ضَرًّا وَلَا نَفْعًا. Last verse. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does. This all started because Samiri took advantage of their guilt. So they made this calf, and the calf made a moo sound. That's it. It didn't say, look, anybody have any questions? I'll answer it for you. Nothing. It didn't even say an actual word. It just made a sound. And these people started to worship it. That was enough. Allah says, don't they see that this calf or this idol, it doesn't own anything. It can't even speak. It can't respond to anything you say. It can't help you in your weaknesses. It can't benefit you or uplift you in any way, shape or form. And that's, you know, what we learn from this as well is one of the challenges for people that worship idols is the guilt that if I stop worshiping, and maybe a curse will come to me. maybe it'll be upset with me because others are still worshiping it. So when they see that others are still dedicated to that idol, they might think to themselves, well, okay, if I don't continue with my dedication, then perhaps something is going to happen to me. I better just stay here. Third and last point that I'll share with you about this whole scene here is that often what happens is Samiri, when he did all of this, it was sort of a cop-out version of commitment to Allah. What do I mean by that? Now they don't have to worry about instructions. They don't have to worry about halal and haram. They don't have to worry about a prophet coming and telling them what to do. They don't have to worry about, okay, you know, somebody, you know, sifting out our mistakes. Now we are free. We can say and we can do anything that we want. Because why? We're only committed to this one calf. It can't stand up. It's not going to follow me in my house. It can't come and listen to me what I'm saying or what I'm doing at home. So this is a good deal here. This is a good package for me. I don't have to worry now. I don't have to be monitored every single time. That's such a convenient option. And so that's why it becomes more attractive. It's that freedom element that's attached to idol worship. So you can go about your day and do whatever you want, say whatever you want, involve whatever you want, and just come back, offer some money, give this idol some food, say something to it, and you're good to go and you walk away. Samiri knew this and took full advantage of that, subhanAllah. So with that being said, we're going to pause here, inshaAllah ta'ala, because now it's going to shift into another scene. Harun alayhi salam is going to come back now. And he's going to step into the conversation. He's basically going to say to everybody, you know, didn't I already warn you about this guy, Samiri? Didn't I tell you about who he was? So he's going to step into the conversation, inshallah ta'ala. So with that being said, to summarize everything that we've mentioned here today, it's really essential and extremely important that we all take the time to continue to ask questions. Be critical as well. Ask when you learn from somebody, ask what their credentials are, ask where they come from, ask where they learned. And anytime somebody gives you a point or direction, ask them for the evidence. Ask them for an ayah or a hadith. Don't fall for, I've never heard that in my life. You know, sometimes I get that, by the way, right? I would get like a student coming to me and be like, yeah, you mentioned that we should recite Quran first before we study the tafsir or before we look at the translation, which I strongly believe, by the way, right? The starting point in building a relationship with the Quran is you learn how to read it first. Put aside tafsir and translation for later. That's later on in the list. Learn how to read Allah's words first, because that in and of itself is ibadah. You're rewarded for that. That's worship. But that is also the biggest gateway to the knowledge of the Quran, is at least you can read its words. And I remember one brother's like, I've never heard that in my life. You know, this doesn't make any sense. And I just said to him, I was like, it doesn't matter what you've heard and what you're accustomed to. Just follow Allah's words, follow the Quran, and follow the Sunnah of our Prophet ﷺ. First thing he taught to all of his companions was how to read the Quran. Then he would teach them and give them an insight of its knowledge. The first revelation was Iqra, not Ifham. It was read, not try to understand what I'm saying to you. Jibreel alayhi salam didn't come and give tafsir to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. That wasn't his first task. First thing was repeat after me. Just say this after me. Teaching him how to read. So these are some of the things that it's important that we're getting from this. But my strongest message to all of you is don't be a victim of those who pry on the religious weaknesses of fellow Muslims. Don't be a victim of that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to give us strength, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to give us the knowledge of this beautiful surah and His Quran. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khairan, guys. We will continue inshaAllah ta'ala tomorrow, and we will continue and journey through this surah. We're actually almost done. We just have a few more pages to go through. But I don't care about what's left. I just care about that as we go through it, we get what we need to get in terms of its lesson, its guidance and benefits, inshaAllah ta'ala. So may Allah Azza wa Jal bless you all and keep you safe and healthy. Allahumma ameen. Jazakumullahu khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.